Dear God, dear stars, dear tree, dear sky, dear people, dear everything, dear God.
Good morning. Welcome to United Church of Christ, Fort Lauderdale. I'd like to welcome all of our internet viewers as well. Those of you at home watching, we welcome you. This is a day of thanksgiving. Our God has been very good to us. It is a day for harvest and celebration. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land God has given to you.
And the days of thanksgiving, and the Lord's hearts of praise, give thanks to God and praise God's name.
The first reading is from Isaiah 12. You will say in that day, I will give thanks to you, O Lord. For though you were angry with me, your anger turned away, and you comforted me. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my might. God has become my salvation. With joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. And you will say in that day, give thanks to the Lord. Call on the Lord's name, make known the deeds among the nations. Proclaim that the Lord's name is exalted. Sing praises to the Lord, for God has done gloriously. Let this be known on all the earth. Shout aloud and sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great is your midst, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel.
Please rise for the reading of the Gospel. The Gospel message this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 21, verses 5 through 19. When some were speaking about the temple, how it was adorned with beautiful stones and gifts dedicated to God, Jesus said, as for these things that you see, the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. All will be thrown down. They asked Jesus, though, Teacher, when will this be and what will be the sign that this is about to take place? Jesus responded, Beware that you're not led astray, for many will come in my name and say, I am he, and the time is near. Do not go after them. When you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately. Then Jesus said to them, Nation will rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes in various places, famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. But before all this occurs, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors because of my name. This will give you an opportunity to testify. So make up your minds not to prepare your defense in advance, for I will give you words and wisdom that none of your opponents will be able to withstand or contradict. You will be betrayed even by parents and brothers, by relatives and friends, and they will put some of you to death. You will be hated by all because of my name. Not a hair on your head will be perished. By your endurance, you will gain your souls. This is the word of God for the people of God. The month, 30 days of gratefulness. But when we read this scripture, it's pretty harsh, isn't it? About what lies ahead, what we're about to endure. How do we find thankfulness and gratefulness in the midst of that? The two passages today speak to us and teach us how. You have to dive deep into the word. There was a man who lived in Phoenix with his wife. And the man calls the son who lives in New York. It was the day before Thanksgiving. And he says to his son, I hate to ruin your day, But it's been 45 years that I've lived with your mother, and I just can't stand another day of this misery. Enough is enough. Pop, what are you talking about? The sunscreen on the telephone. The dad says, we can't stand the sight of each other any longer. We're sick of each other, and I'm telling you this so you can call your sister in St. Louis and you can tell her also. Frantically, the son calls his sister in St. Louis and says, you won't believe this, but Mom and Dad are getting a divorce. The sister says, oh, no, they're not. Said, I'm booking the flight for both of us, and I'm calling them. She called and said, Mom and Dad, we'll be there tomorrow. Don't do a thing. So the old man hangs up the phone and says, okay, honey, they're coming for Thanksgiving and paying their own way. Sometimes you might not understand what's going on around us, but there is a legitimate reason and cause. In the first reading from Isaiah the prophet today, the line that stood out the most is, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, for though you were angry with me, your anger turned away and you comforted me. God being angry at us? But we preach Sunday after Sunday, God loves us as God's children. What do you mean being angry? What was God angry about? And I had to think about that. Think about when we teach our children to walk across the street safely. You know, you teach them so that one day they can make the trek and be safe when they get to the other side. But then you may stand back and watch, and you watch as the child didn't listen to you. The child didn't look both ways. The child didn't even obey the hand signal that's up waiting for the walk sign. Just walk right into traffic. A car almost hit the little child. You're angry. You go to your child. What were you thinking? What were you thinking? How can you do that? I taught you better. Yeah. So anger does come as a parental role. But then you turn your anger away and you think and you know that this is my child. I could have lost my child just like that. And you comfort the child and you love the child. Sometimes we get angry. Not sometimes, often. And we blame God for it. I can hear us saying, why can't I have this my way? Why can't I find the job that I want, that I need, God? Why can't I have the clothes or the vacations I want? Why can't I have the relationship I'm looking for? Where are you? What's wrong? I don't feel your presence around me. I'm angry. Then we go to the root of feeling sorry for ourselves. What's wrong with me? Why doesn't God love me? I'm not worthy. But like the scared child scolded by the parent, we have the option of being comforted through all of that. In reality, God has already given us what we need. We just don't know. Don't acknowledge that. Because God has given us salvation through the sacrifices of His own Son. That's what we have. God has given us the strength and the might that we need if we only say yes to it. We say, talk about we're searching, and it's already there for us to say yes. We already have what we need. And a friend of mine said one time, I hear you say that, but I work with people who are in emergencies or just in a crisis, and I can't tell them right then and there, you know, God's here, you know, you have what you need, when they just lost their child, or when this spouse just passed or something. I said, I realize that. But you're there to comfort them. That's where God is. Your sense of presence is more important. But through the person expressing love, that love is present to provide comfort. And that person, that victim, might not realize it at the time. But just because we don't see something doesn't mean that it's not there. When that person looks back, they'll realize, I was comforted. I wasn't alone. God was present with me. During our time of challenges in our life, we're invited to draw from our faith, and that's the readings today, and our trust in God's love. As Apostle Paul reminds us in Acts 17:28, for in God we live and we move, and have our being, for we are also God's children. For in God we live and we move as God's children. And we hear from Isaiah, for God is great, and God is in our midst. The divine is in our midst. We're born in God's image. The gospel reading today from the book of Luke, reading it again. All this challenges, a nation rising above against nations and kingdoms against kingdoms, and your family turning on you and being in prison, and then losing even your relatives and your friends, and you may also, some of you may be put to death. It's a harsh passage. But in this reading, we need to put it in context. Jesus had entered the temple during this time. He was there to reclaim it. But his efforts had been rebuffed by the temple leadership. He witnessed what was going on by the leadership in the temple. And Jesus censures those who refuse to hold themselves accountable before God. God, Jesus, tells him this can't happen this way. That in order for us to correct this, every stone must be removed. The temple would be gone. But he's upset with them because they're using, and he notices this, they're using religious and political positions and the temple system itself, in the temple's name, to oppress and tyrannize the vulnerable. They're taking advantage of the oppressed and the vulnerable when their call and their purpose is to do the opposite. Things have gone astray. And he says the days will come when not one stone will be left upon another. They didn't know what that meant, probably. What's he talking about? All will be thrown down. Jesus was referring to the destruction of the temple, the death of the old way. In order to live the life that we want, that God wants for us, we must be willing to let go of the doubt and fear that overwhelms the life that we're in. The destruction of that old way of thinking must occur in the reconstruction of the stones that Jesus talked about, building the new life in which we're invited to live and walk and breathe. That's what I see in this reading. It's easy to concentrate on the tyranny and the destruction and the bad. But there's new life in this reading. We have the sacred scriptures. We have Jesus, the example. We have the instruction manual right here. The instruction manual. One of the, and I love that, it talks about people who are false prophets. Beware when I leave you. There will be false prophets that come along. But do not listen to them. Not many people would think, am I following the right person? I'm really not sure. And my response is always, are you following Jesus? Are you following Jesus in His way? But we also have modern day prophets too. Then you have another prophet, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Because in the scriptures today, Luke tells us that when you work in my name, Jesus says, when you work in my name, you could end up being in prison. And he was. He was in Birmingham, Alabama with a legal protest, but was arrested and put in jail. He was put in prison, this prophet. But in the midst of that, he had some paper and a pen. Because the local, 8 white local clergy people had come to him and they had said to him, you are doing too much too fast. You need to calm down a little. Things will change. Yeah, we agree with you, but this is too fast. So he wrote a letter. It's called a letter from the Birmingham jail. In that letter, he writes, they will arrest you and persecute you. They will hand you over to the synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings. He reminds him of that passage. But he says, I'm in Birmingham because of injustices here. Just as the 8th century prophets left their little villages and carried their, thus said the Lord, far beyond the boundaries of their hometowns. And just as the Apostle Paul left his little village, carried the gospel of Jesus Christ to every hamlet and city in the Greco-Roman world, I too am compelled to carry the gospel of freedom beyond my particular hometown, he says. But he says, like Paul, I must constantly respond to the call for aid. Moreover, I'm cognizant of the interrelatedness of all communities and states. I cannot sit idly by in Atlanta and not be concerned about what happens in Birmingham. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. We're caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects us indirectly. What happens to one happens to us all. What about the children who were shot and killed in the school this week? What about in San Diego, after that, another shooting and killing? What affects us one affects us all. Other clergy told Martin Luther King to take it easy, you're doing too much, too fast, too soon. Tell that to the families that were affected by the shooting. Surely God is my salvation. I will trust and will not be afraid, for the Lord God is my strength and my might. The Lord has become my salvation. From the song that you sang to open the service, it reminded me of the faith we're supposed to have. My favorite line was at the end. You sang, I think this is the youngest I've ever felt. That spoke to me. I think this is the youngest I've ever felt. The choir can tell you that relates to me because I think I'm 12. I feel like I'm that. We're invited to feel that way, but not as a child, but in our enthusiasm to love one another. We're all invited to be that way, to break down those walls that have been created to prevent us from doing so. That's the message today. I think this is the youngest I've ever felt. Sometimes my body doesn't agree, but it's okay. I don't care. I won't change. So concerned about following false prophets, let us follow the teachings of Isaiah the prophet, of Luke, of Martin Luther King, of Maya Angelou, of all the prophets around us. Who do we listen to? Do you hear what I hear? Amen.
Just standing inside the hands, can't stop the fire from rising. The skin don't define any human. The stars are the only thing shooting on. Still echoing my praise.
Our hands are
God's hands.
And our feet are
God's feet.
And our very words are
God's words.
Let's go in peace. Let's go in peace to serve and love the Lord.